morning and welcome you all for the session of Network Artificial Intelligence. So in this session, I would like to share the experience that we had in embracing AI and analytics for network management. So it was more than management. We were even trying to use it for the network control. So in general, when we go for analytics, the most important thing is data. The more data that we have, we could run analytics on this data, and then we could get some actionable outputs. So from networking point of view, we wanted all this data from these networking devices, and that's where we need these telemetries. So we wanted these telemetry to be streaming and real time. And there is work being done in this regard in IETF with respect to Yang Push, which exposes the complete data store to be accessible for collection. And there are other open source like gRPC, which does support service-end events. A lot of things are happening which we can use. And in the next session, we can see that Shweta will be talking about in-situ OM, which gives us a lot of information about a link, a path, or a service, and which gives a lot of information that can be used for interesting analytics, which we can use for managing the network. We also tried out some amount of middleware-based transport, which I'll be covering a little later. And coming to analytics, when we come to analytics, for example, we do have, what Dhruv mentioned, we need to have analytics at runtime. It is in real time, you should be able to find out, for example, there is some issue that is happening in the network. We should be able to detect those anomalies and take corrective or preventive actions. And we could also use it for creating self-healing networks auto bandwidth kind of networks, self-provision networks. So for all these things, we want these analytics to be real time. So for this, we should be able to churn the massive amount of data in real time. So we use some of the techniques that is there in big data to process this data, and we use streaming concepts to do stream processing. And we have used some tools and technologies like Beam, Flink, Kafka, Elasticsearch, Influx, a lot of things. Then now when we come, how do we make it relevant to networking is how effectively we could take these results and then take it back to the control loop. That is, how can we take the results, for example, if there is DDoS attack that has been detected? How can we mitigate this so that once the analytics detects a DDoS attack, what kind of attack is happening, where is the location, it could give those information to the controller, and the controller can take the action on the network and then mitigate it from there. So the kind of actions could be reactive, it could be predictive, it could be based on the history data that we have, we could get insights. So that is where the closed loop with respect to networking makes sense for us. Okay, so in the previous slide where Dhruv mentioned about telemetry, in case, for example, if you use a simple Google Maps, we do get the live information about what is happening, where the traffic is more, which routes you should avoid. So these are all possible today's date because there is streaming telemetry that is happening. There is live collection of data that is coming from the actual real world to a central place, and it is able to make decision based on what is the current situation. So likewise, in networking, we would like to collect the data from the devices at real time, have it available at the analytics center where we could apply analytics. And then like what I mentioned before, we could use the analytics to take a preventive action or a corrective action or a predictive action. So what we want to do is with telemetry, we collect a lot of data, which gives us insight into what is happening in the network. So these insights are the visibility that we get a visibility like what is happening on a link to what is happening all the way at the service. So using these visibility, we could transform these insights into business values. For example, how we could improve the network throughput, how we can improve the network availability, how we can make more network more efficient. So these are the places where we want to use analytics and make analytics useful and make sense for networking. Okay, so when we talk about telemetry, what we had in what do you say, the legacy telemetry with IETF is we had concepts like SNMP where we could collect data, and it was more like a pull-based thing. Yes, there were traps, but it was limited to the event notification. So, and these were good at that time for the network management. But when we want to extend it for, what do you say, streaming kind of telemetry, it did have its gaps. So that is where IETF has worked towards streaming telemetry concepts, where it did come up with concepts of NetConf, Yang, and RestConf, but it was still limited to query-based thing. And then we came up with Yang Push. So where in Yang Push, the whole store is exposed, and the what do you say, the apps could subscribe to the data of its interest, and then they could always get the latest update, what is happening in real time. So what do you say, this is the direction where we could control the data that what we want, at what rate we want, what do you say, how often we want. So all these things is there, like wherein the interested party subscribes for it, and the publisher just publishes the data that is being generated at that moment of time. So, okay. So now we do have the concept of all these telemetry, for example, Yang Push, they're all driven from the concept of more of a physical device box that we have. But when we look at the SDN NFV world, we are trying to virtualize all the network elements and then have it hosted in the data centers. So like typical how data center application can scale in, scale out, it could be migrated, it could move. So what happens is the management of these devices for the telemetry itself will be an overhead. So typically, like we could learn from what is there in the SDN based applications where they just publish it on the bus, and then the interested applications get it on the are listening on the bus for their data. On similar lines, we could also see if we could enhance our telemetry so that it could send the streaming data onto the bus, and then our analytic apps could pull those data from the VNS directly. So in this scenario, what happens is the management for having this telemetry advised would be advertised would be still more simpler and easier. And the next part that we have seen is traditionally when we did come up with NetConf, RestConf, Yang, we did make it simple with encoding with JSON and XML, and made the management simpler. But when we move towards streaming telemetry, where we're talking about massive amount of data that is being generated, and we want everything, potentially everything that we want to see it from the network, we should be able to pull it and see it. So in such scenarios, we could see if it is a possibility to optimize the way we send data from these networking devices. Could we use some kind of binary, format of encoding, wherein it is basically for machine-machine communication, where it is more machine-friendly. It avoids the lot of overheads. It also makes it much more faster for transportation. So we did try in this direction for our network telemetry. So this is all about telemetry. So now once we have collected the data, we wanted to do the analytics. So in analytics, initially when we started, we did go the traditional way of batch analytics. So there were use cases, for example, a monthly report or a quarterly report, where it makes sense to find the insights of what is happening in the business. So where we could get insights on a monthly report, for example, but the same thing we wanted to do for some use cases like a credit card fraud detection or something, we want it to happen then and there. When a fraud is detected, can we take a preemptive action? Can we prevent the transaction? So for such scenarios, we wanted streaming analytics. So in the big data world, it was already there, but it was not in a single step. So initially there was a Lambda architecture where the same data that was collected would be fed to the batch analytics, and it would also be fed to the streaming analytics. So the streaming analytics would take care of detecting these kind of anomalies and giving it to the servicing layer. The batch would take care of the periodic batch to update the models or generate the insights, and then there will be a servicing layer which would give out. So what happens is when we see like this is not pure streaming, because the way we write programs is slightly different. Maybe sometimes we need to write some part in batch, some part in streaming, maybe sometimes both in both the places. So it is, and sometimes the data is being fed to two systems and then trying to be done parallel two times. So it was not a seamless approach for us. So, but with our learning, we were able to adopt the new streaming analytics, which is called the CAP architecture, where we try to do analytics for data in motion. That is, when the data is being generated, we try and capture the data, and then we run the data through analytics. So basically, in case of streaming, what happens is the algorithms are all like incremental algorithms, which can work on the delta data that is collected. So it, makes streaming possible. But for this entire thing to be really successful, we need to ensure that we can have consistency in our, streaming computation. So we need to make sure that there is exactly once, there could be failures in a cluster. So we need to ensure that there is exactly one semantic. So if we can address that, or if we can assure that, then it definitely makes sense. So that is where we did choose some tools which will help us. Now coming to the use cases where in networking it makes sense. Like what we said, like if there is a DDoS attack, we need to detect when a DDoS attack is happening so that we could recover the network from attack, or we could recover a user from the attack. Or maybe there is a node that has gone down. Could I recover the network and make sure that the service is still not impacted? So right now, the current way, like we do ensure that the network is resilient to failures, but how do we do it at the cost of the backup parts and other things? So with analytics, what we can do is we could increase those throughput by ensuring that there is a constant telemetry which gets to know what is happening in the system. And when there is a failure, it can take the best decision at that given point of time. So that is where, in case of like, we could go to the direction of auto bandwidth, self-healing, self-optimized networks. So for all these things, when we have sufficient data that is collected about a network or a period of time, we can build how the network behaves. We could understand the network models and then even predict, and we can even have the network geared up for a particular event. Maybe there is a football match and then we expect a lot of traffic going on in a particular area. We could scale up and we can gear it up. So nothing needs to be done manually. There is telemetry is constantly collecting. It is trying to figure out what is happening. There could be other inputs that we could give into this analytics from the the outside world. What is the business kind of inputs? So it could do a lot of correlation where the lot of interesting things could be done with analytics to networking. And so like what we said, for streaming to be really successful, we need to ensure that there is exactly one semantics. So Flink is the tool that we have used, which assures that exactly one semantics. So it it is stateful and fault tolerant. So when any computation is going on, it knows what is the status of computation, any issues is there, it could recover from it. And it can perform at large scale. It is more like a big data platform for analytics. So it can meet streaming big data analytics for the networking use case. And it also has, because when we're going for streaming, what happens is we could have the data that is coming a little late, or it could be out of order. So as a framework, it is supporting in itself how you could write applications which can handle these data that is coming in out of order or later fashion. So go towards this analytic platform, like initially worked with analytics, initially we did write our batch analytics, and then we saw, okay, there is a need for Lambda, we wrote something in Lambda, then we see, okay, there's a need for stream, we went for stream. Now all these things, what happens is whenever we moved the same business case code from one architecture or from one use case to another use case, there was a lot of refactoring of the code that was required. The reason being is the code was written more specific for each of the tools or each of the ways in which we are using it. So there was no abstraction. So initially there was Google's Cloud Dataflow, which used the abstraction of Dataflow to tell how these, the transactions or the analytics could be abstracted. So in that abstract model, it could be applied seamlessly for both stream and batching. a batch processing. So what do you say? We used Beam. Beam is a unified programming model which can be used to do our analytics for stream, analytics for batch. It also can keep your program really independent. Can you, today's date, we chose Flink. For some reason, we say, okay, now we want to change from Flink to Gear Pump or some other thing. We could do so as long as those runners are available in Beam, and then we could just, our existing apps could run on the new environment or new deployment. So that is the reason why we chose Beam in our approach. Now, when we say that we want to have the analytics, we felt that it is better to have the analytics to be done as a platform. Why do we say that we need to have analytics to be done as a platform? Like, we could draw analogy with SDN. If you take SDN control, it's more like a platform kind of thing. It has got a core set of services, and it is flexible and extensible to add new SBIs, new applications, because the world is evolving. For example, today's date, we have a set of telemetry. Tomorrow, something new can come in. Or for example, I want to get insights of what is happening on the virtualization environment. I could use some Prometheus exporters or something to collect the data. So what happens is, there should not be any, hard dependency on a particular transport or particular technology. So we have it as more of a platform where it is, it supports for extensions wherein we could add new telemetry mechanisms, we could add new protocol support. And as a platform, what happens is, we are looking at network. The networks could be like a ISP network, which is really huge. The amount of data that is being generated over there would be huge and massive. And it is not that always it is going to be there. There would be times where some kind of events happen or there is a DDoS at a particular time of time, and then you need to take some kind of action. So what happens is, you need your applications to scale up and scale down. So all these things can be offloaded from the application. We can put it in the platform, which can take care of the lifecycle management of all these applications. And then we also have, once it becomes a platform, when what happens is, each of those applications could reuse what is there in the platform, and then they only concentrate on their business use case rather than putting effort on trying to do what is already being done or trying to do what is not required for the business case, maybe more from the technology point of it. So for all these reasons, we felt going with the platform makes sense. And on a high level, top level architecture was, we had these, the collectors platform where we could add our new collectors. So for example, we want to have a gRPC collector, we could have our YAML based collector, or we could have our VS collector. So we could just, it's extensible to add new collectors depending on what is being available at the network. So they collect the telemetry from the network and keep it, make it available for the applications above through a bus. And then the applications which is interested in a particular kind of telemetry information, it could pull those information, and then it could do the specific analytics in the application there. So once the application has made got an actionable result, it feeds those results to the SDN controller. So that's where the closed loop happens. Once the previously SDN controller, it was more like a brute force method, like it knew like what it had to do if some event happened. So it knew, it was like pre-programmed. So here with analytics, we could also have it learn and evolve over a period of time. And based on its updated, learning, it could give the best actionable result, which the SDN can take. So SDN would go and then program the network based on what instructions it got from the analytics. So by that way, we could have the closed loop completed, and we could have the analytics which will complement the controller. So I just told us like this, the closed loop could be for managing the network. It could be for orchestrating the the VNFs. It could be self-healing. For all those use cases, we could use closed loop. Now, in our use case, in one of the use cases, what we did was, we used S-Flow as a telemetry protocol to collect all the traffic information that is going in the network. So we constantly collected the traffic information from the devices onto our collector. And In this case, we had used DDS. That is, we integrated DDS, which is a bus-based transport, into the OVS itself, and had OVS advertise the telemetry data onto the bus, so it could have these data available to our collectors, which was listening on the bus. And once it was there available, it was fed to the traffic prediction app. So based on all the raw samples, it was able to model what are the services that is there, what kind of traffic is going on, what is the behavior of each of the traffic, and it was able to predict it. So based on its prediction, it would tell the onus controller that this particular service would require X amount of bandwidth. So depending on the requirement for this much time, so onus would configure the network so that it could find maybe the current path. For example, it was going from ABC and ADC, where ABC was limited for X bandwidth. When the prediction says you will need Y bandwidth, which is more than X, so current path which was set on ABC would be changed to ADC. So all this insight was there in from the prediction that was there in the NTI app, and the signaling was done through ONOS. So we could have the the path setup, which is dynamic and real time, and it is the oversubscription is avoided. So it also had the feedback of what is happening on the live, so it could also correct with what is happening on the live. Okay, so this was the output that a simple output that we have. For example, the blue lines over there denote what is the actual traffic that is going on. The orange line over there denotes what is the prediction that is happening. So we could see that if you happen to see all those yellow lines, initially they are not really matching with what is happening in the real world. That is because sufficient data has not been collected over a period of time. So initially, with that initial amount of data, what is the model that it detected, it is trying to predict. And based on that prediction, we could see whether it is mimicked in the real world, could we depend on these predictions. Once reliable amount of prediction is reliable to what is happening in the real world, we could switch to the actual prediction. Now, if you happen to see over there, at every level, initially, as and when the predictions become better and better with more available data, we could see that prediction is going ahead of time of what is the current. So we could make sure that the network is geared for what is going to happen. So now, actually, with IETF, what we look forward is, can we interact with IETF to see the options of having a bus-based transport, like what we said for virtualized VNFs. It makes sense to have this data being available on a bus-based transport. So is it possible for have some kind of telemetry with bus enabled? And then we did see the advantages that we get when we go to, the binary-based encoding. And these binary-based encoding, apart from performance of serialization, apart from performance of, overhead, they're also, native for the programming also, so it does help. And with, NMLRG is a working group where network machine learning research group, where we could also see like what are the kind of use cases that we could use for network analytics. And we already have open source projects like DCAE in ONAP and Panda, which is working on applying analytics for the networking use space. We could work with it to use it and then enhance it to make these things more usable for the networking use cases. And there are a bunch of open source libraries which support machine learning algorithms. We could see if we could use them and see how well we could use these algorithms and make sense for our networking use case. So these is my few thoughts that I had from the experience that we had with respect to machine learning. If you have any queries, you could let me know and we could discuss about it.
Hi, Vinod. One question on if you go to your architecture slide, the NAI block that you have, can you give us an idea about the scale of resources required to realize that block? What kind of servers or server farms would you need to realize that in a real network?
Okay. So in our test network, we used a smaller thing. It is not a production grade yet. But for our test network, we could do it with simple one server where we could able to manage about 40 node network. One server with 32 core was sufficient to handle about 40 node network.
Do you plan to use some hardware offload for doing some form of analytics there, especially at the collection point, or is it all in software?
Okay, now for collection, we could, like what you said, we could offload this collection to a separate hardware to do the collection, or like what we tried, could we have this data available on the bus, wherein my analytics could start with this collection, that is, my pipeline would start with the I/O in which it receives the actual telemetry data. So if we do that, we don't need a separate hardware for the collection platform. If, for example, we are having traditional protocols, which is not coming as, what do you say, native I/O to my analytics, yes, we could have dedicated hardware which could receive it and then further have it advertised on the bus, which can have it available for my application. We do have a hackathon in which we would like to showcase what we have done with, what do you say, the S-Flow use case. And we are trying to, in that we already use the bus-based technology. We are trying to get the, what do you say, the protobuf concept into it. So feel free to approach us and get more information about it, what we have done, or just share our experience about it.
One question.
Yeah.
Related to whatever the use case that you have shown there, is there any place where we could get what sort of data that is collected for that particular use case?
See, in our particular use case, what we did was we had the S-Flow sampling. So practically every traffic that was going through the switch or the OVS switches would be sampled at a sampling interval and sent to us. So depending on the sampling interval, we would try to extrapolate what is the actual traffic for that particular kind of traffic that we're receiving.
Okay, so it's just about how many packets that are flowing in, or like what?
No, it is just about sampling packets at a particular interval. So depend based on the probability, potentially we will find like different kinds of traffic samples. So based on that, it has a complete header, or at least the initial part of the traffic, the payload. So based on those headers, we will be able to find out for which service it is there, for which, what do you say, between which endpoints, what path it is taking, we'll be able to figure out all those things.
Thanks.
Thank you.